Well, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Marianne.
Maybe the first thing you can do is tell me your name.
I'm Cynthia Hoven.
Okay.
And I teach Eurythmy here at Riddle Center College, and I also work in private practice.
Okay.
Teaching Eurythmy with clients, patients, and children.
And children as well.
But my greatest love is teaching Eurythmy to adults.
Yeah. Now tell me, because you have a certain destiny, and Eurythmy is the love of your life. And
absolutely.
Now, how did you have any inkling about this when you were a child?
Actually, no. I grew up in Chicago, the middle child of a very typical middle-class family in the middle of America.
Uh-huh.
And my father was an electrical engineer. We were surrounded by televisions. Color televisions.
Oh.
My father developed the prototypes for color televisions, so we always had the samples to come to my house.
The newest.
And my mother had a master's degree in religious education. And I found myself tremendously interested in the polarity between science and religion.
Uh-huh.
And my mother actually had a great interest in Edgar Cayce and Jean Dixon and life after death and spirituality of all sorts. And so I found myself asking, how can I bridge these two worlds that I'm so interested in? And I vividly remember a childhood conversation I had with my mother one night when I was 12 years old. And as she was putting me to bed, I said, Mom, is there any way that I can bridge science, which I love, and religion and spirituality? She said, you can become a parapsychologist.
Oh.
What's that? You can research psychic phenomena. Said, that's it. Perfect.
Uh-huh.
And so from the age of 12 all the way through the time when I finished my university degree, I was aiming to be a parapsychologist.
Uh-huh.
And that was back in the 60s when most people had no idea what parapsychology was.
Right.
So I was a very proficient student, and I got two bachelor degrees. From Purdue University, one of them in math and physics, and the other in psychology. And when I had completed them, and I was ready to look for graduate schools, I stopped myself dead in my tracks, and I said, actually, it's time for me to go see the world first. I know nothing about what I want to study yet. It's all abstract. So I bought a one-way ticket to Europe, and this was in 1972, and I decided that I wanted to go to India and possibly find a spiritual teacher from the East.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the years when people
were
beginning to
do that. Yes, I think everybody was doing that. It was amazing.
It was marvelous how many people were on the road back then.
It was
a small tribe of people on the journey to see the world. And I joined them with my backpack on my back, and I ended up traveling for 2 years. And I am so grateful for that.
Up and down India or something?
Not just. I started out with 4 months in Europe and then went to Istanbul. And in Istanbul, I met some Swedes who had a Volkswagen van that they were driving to India.
Mm-hmm.
And we took a month to drive from Istanbul through Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and finally arrive in India. And to experience this journey through deep history, driving through these thousands of miles of desert, desolation, into these cultures that had barely seen people like us traveling.
Right.
I was stripped to my bare minimum. And then we came to the hubbub of India, and actually I soon discovered that that wasn't my place. I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, didn't resonate with it.
Mm-hmm.
I loved Nepal. I loved being in Kashmir. Went to Dharamsala, where the Dalai Lama is.
Mm-hmm.
Then it was time to decide to go home. A year was up, and I said, no, I'm not ready yet. I still have more to see.
Mm-hmm.
And so I bought a one-way ticket to continue further east.
Mm-hmm.
And to my surprise, this was long before anyone else was doing it, I went off the beaten track. I went to Thailand, Laos.
Mm-hmm.
And I was even in Vietnam when the troops were still on the ground at the end of the Vietnam War.
Wow.
And traveled around there for 2 weeks by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And met some deep, deep, deep destiny there.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of that, continued on and landed in Japan, where I studied with a Kundalini yoga master and acupuncturist.
Uh-huh.
And the fun thing was, that's where I met anthroposophy. I met a young American there, and this American had met a Vietnamese Eurythmist named To, whom I've met in the meantime. He had met To in Ireland at Skellig Michael, where I had been, and To had given him the book Knowledge of Higher Worlds. And this American had taken the book all the way through all the countries that I had been through, as if the book was following me, and gave it to me in Japan and said, you might be interested in this book. And this was Rudolf Steiner's work, Knowledge of Higher Worlds.
Uh-huh.
And I gave it back to him at the end of that, and I never saw this American again. But something about this journey mm-hmm. spoke deeply to me.
Mm-hmm.
And when my time in Japan was up, I went back to the States and was wondering, now what?
Yeah.
Do I want to be a parapsychologist still? And in fact, I went even deeper.
You were still in your early 20s then?
Yeah, I was 21.
Wow.
And I said to myself at that point, actually, I want to find a spiritual art form of healing, or an art form that works in a healing way with spiritual laws.
Yeah.
And that's...
And you recognized that as young as that?
Yes.
It's amazing.
It really fits in with my 12-year-old question.
Yeah, yeah.
And at that point then, that question, that specifically formed question, led me to Eurythmy.
And so... And where did you find that then?
Down in Southern California, and I met two women, Jean Schwarzkopf, Jean Moore at that time, who became Jean Schwarzkopf, and Karen Sherman, who became Karen McPherson. And they had just
returned. And they still were both young, too.
They were 35, I think.
Something 30, like that, yeah. In their middle 30s.
Yes, and they had just returned from Europe, where they had done their training and had worked for a few years, and they had come back to California to see how they could contribute to Eurythmy
uh-huh.
here in California.
So who did they do Eurythmy with in Europe?
With Ilona Schubert, first of all, who was a direct student of Rudolf Steiner's.
Mm-hmm.
And they got their diplomas through the goodwill and the cooperation of Ilona Tsukali.
Oh, okay.
Elena Tsukali.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Both of them?
Yes.
So they both went through the same school there?
Yes.
Uh-huh, okay. Yeah. Donna.
Yeah. A very untraditional training.
Yeah.
They had gone to visit a few different schools, and in the end they decided to have a private training with Ilona Schubert,
mm-hmm.
and then Tsukali, Frau Tsukali, agreed to give them the diplomas.
Uh-huh, uh-huh, okay.
And then they did some very pioneer work and some performing and came back to California. And here they worked with Willy Sucher, who had been their mentor.
Yeah.
And Willy Sucher had moved up here to Northern California, and that's why they chose to come here. And a small group of us were attracted to their work, and we were the first group of students who worked with them, and I'm one of only three people who actually graduated from that training. That.
Yeah, yeah. So you were the first one really, in a way, that graduated in North America. I mean, apart from, I don't know, was Spring Valley giving?
They were just about parallel with us at
yeah,
that time.
Yeah, yeah, because they started around that time too, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And I was actually surprised to find myself doing this work, because I had thought of myself as a scientist
yeah.
and a researcher.
Right.
And I didn't think that I would be a mover. Possibly I thought I would work with painting, with music. But Eurythmy spoke so deeply to my core that mm-hmm. I immediately thought I could follow this path. And I remember when I first met Jean Schwarzkopf, she said to me, I chose to study Eurythmy because I recognize it as a path that never ends.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually been my
yes.
experience as well.
Yes, yes.
It gives such an access to a living experience of knowledge
yeah.
rather than to a dead conceptual field.
Exactly, yeah.
That I felt.
You can't just think it.
You can't think it. You have to yeah. completely engage the very core of yourself to do
yeah.
Eurythmy.
Yeah, yeah.
And obviously, as you know also, Marianne, there's nothing like it on the planet.
Oh, I know, I know.
Yeah.
I just wish that more people could do it.
I absolutely wish
that too. Steiner said we should do it on the street. I mean, to do beautiful rhythm, I mean, for a good start.
What else could we want?
Exactly, yeah.
So when I first came to Eurythmy, I was told before my first classes that Eurythmy would be visible music and visible speech. And when I heard that it was visible music, I thought, I can understand that. It must be like dance somehow, but visible speech. I have no idea why that should be interesting.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until I got into deeper and deeper into the experience of Eurythmy that I could understand how profound it is that in Eurythmy we actually move the word.
I mean, instead of the larynx.
Instead of the
you
larynx.
You become the whole word in movement in with your own body.
And so this harkens back to the old mystery streams, the ancient mystery streams that speak about how the entire creation was spoken into being by the creator.
Yeah.
That speaks of the creative cosmic word.
Yeah.
And of course, in the Christian theology, we have that in the John's Gospel. Mm-hmm. It says, in the beginning was the Word.
Right.
But we find that in Sanskrit. We find that in the Aboriginal writings of the Australians. We find from different traditions all around the world, people speak of the cosmic Word.
Yeah.
And I've been tracking that all my life.
Mm-hmm.
And in Eurythmy, then, that finally came to life for me.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I value very much the work of Georg Kulevind, who wrote about becoming aware of the logos.
Right.
And he speaks in of how one can understand that creator spirit had world wisdom internally and chose to create. And choosing to create is, in that sense, speaking.
Yeah.
We put our inmost self out when we put words onto the breath of air, and creator spirit did that in world creating. And so all of this stream of becoming from the original intention of creator through world wisdom, through love, through movement, has become the forms of bushes and trees and rocks and all the things that are around us in the world.
That we name.
All the things that we give name to, absolutely.
And you can see how deep some of the words go when, you know, somebody who is an adult says, well, when I was a child, somebody said,
absolutely,
you will never amount to anything, or you will be the greatest, or whatever. So words go deep.
They're powerful creators of reality.
Yeah.
And so when we try to understand that the sounds of language, the actual sounds of language are powerful creative entities. In fact, if we go deeply enough, we can understand them to be beings.
And
when we do Eurythmy, we dance with the creative, sculptural, dynamic forces that have made rocks and trees and bushes, and that have made our bodies that we live in. And so in Eurythmy, in a sense, we're dancing the dance of creator.
And what does Steiner say? If you put the zodiac, I mean, which is the consonants, and if you put whatever it is in the right order, you can speak a human being into creation, and that will be the future in some way. So,
absolutely.
But we're not there yet, thank heavens.
We're not there yet, thank heavens.
Yeah.
And another thing I am so inspired by is that in the process of doing Eurythmy, we have to become active and aware of all the different layers of our own beingness.
Yeah.
Every person who does Eurythmy has a profound experience of spiritual embodiment and sacred embodiment and mindful movement. So in Eurythmy, we become aware of the flesh and the blood and the bones and how miraculous it is that we have been able to convene these cells and these molecules so that they can be a temple for us
mm-hmm.
for the decades of our life.
Mm-hmm.
And they have to become luminous and penetrating.